Travel restrictions, stricter social distancing measures, and disruptions in supply chain among reasons behind the first quarter decline in core net profit at Gokongwei-led conglomerate JG Summit Holdings. With us now for more is Lance Gokongwei, the president and CEO of JG Summit Holdings. Good to see you, Lance. Welcome to the program.
Good morning.
Right, so how's business been through the lockdown?
I think, as you can imagine, business has been extremely challenging. At this time, clearly the necessary measures taken by the government to prevent the outbreak of the COVID virus require social distancing, and social distancing has had a strong negative effect clearly on a lot of businesses, as most businesses require some human interaction. So we're seeing clearly the effects of the necessary measures on a lot of our businesses.
Right, and it is indeed a conglomerate, so the impact is so much greater. Just taking through the numbers, Q1 core net profit and attributable net profit both down 19% and 70% year on year respectively because of the disruptions relating to COVID-19. So how will Q2 look like? The full quarter that's taken in the full brunt of the lockdown.
I think we expect to see more challenged numbers in the Q2. We're seeing probably the most extreme negatives of all the necessary social distancing measures. We have a large aviation and tourism portfolio as part of our businesses, and the aviation sector has basically not been operating between March 15th. And today we're only basically flying at about 2% of our previous capacity. So this will cause, of course, tremendous effects as we are keeping the bulk of our cost base, whereas our revenue base is less than 5% of where it was at its peak. We're also seeing, of course, other effects, particularly as a lot of our mall businesses, for instance, our hotel businesses, our retail businesses, a lot of consumers are staying at home and probably are not are more conscious about being more thrifty and saving their money for more essential items at this point.
Yeah, despite the dire forecast, especially for the airlines business, I was just looking at JG Summit shares. They've enjoyed quite a decent run-up since mid-May. Just take a look at the chart. Since March 13th, it's been one of the biggest gainers in the previous weeks. To what would you attribute this?
I think the market probably recognizes that the effects of COVID are probably shorter term. I think markets tend to look ahead. Couple of years ahead, and they do recognize that JG Summit is really a diversified business full of strong business leaders. We have a very prudent management, pragmatic, at the same time realistic, and we do have a strong balance sheet. So we are confident that the next couple of years, that as the economy recovers, as employment recovers, and our business continue to be customer-centric, then and adjust to changing consumer demand, then we will be well positioned to benefit from the so-called new normal and the return of the economic growth to this country.
Yeah, to your point on the new normal, this lockdown has really given you and your team a chance to review the current business and operating models. So what shifts have you seen in the way consumers buy or use your products and services?
I think each of our businesses have been affected in different ways, but I would characterize the new normal in three ways. One is really the change in consumer and channel behavior. For instance, what we're seeing now is that a lot of sari-sari stores have been closed during lockdown. A lot of businesses moved to larger outlets, modern trade. In modern trade, we're seeing less frequent visits, but larger basket sizes. Overall, likewise, we're seeing a very rapid move to e-commerce, so that and that requires companies like URC, for instance, to start selling through these social selling channels. We're also seeing the acceleration of setup of e-commerce channels for our retail businesses. We're also seeing changes in consumption habits. No, we're seeing a lot stronger sales of products that are consumed at home, such as instant noodles, biscuits, coffee. But we're also seeing a slump in some products that are usually consumed out of home, for instance, confectionery or ready-to-drink beverages. So I think the second thing we have to recognize is that the new normal requires digitalization. It requires changing the way we work. We have to enable our employees to work from home, allow digital signatures, and that eventually will probably have longer term effects in the way people go about work, no? Having a more flexible workforce. And the third thing we have to see is really the effects really on employment. I think the COVID has had some effects on employment. So naturally, I think people are more careful about their spend. They're probably going to spend more money on essential items. There's also concerns about health and safety at this point, social distancing. So we expect that the airline and travel business will take a longer time to recover.
Yeah, on the travel business, how are you gauging consumer confidence to fly again? I know that you've offered the annual piece of fare promo last Friday for next year's travels. How did that go? The promo was set to end yesterday or until seats sell out. And I see that there are still available flights as of a couple of hours ago.
I think there's a lot of, I think our foremost priority as an airline is to ensure that our employees and our passengers are offered a safe way to travel. So we're putting in all the necessary steps in terms of contactless travel, from the process of booking all the way to check in to the flights. We're ensuring that the absolute highest safety standards are imposed, following international rules set up by the International Civil Aviation Organization. All our planes are very modern. They all have HEPA filters, which are equivalent to what are in medical ICU rooms, and they basically in a cabin. About all the air in there is replaced every 3 minutes, no, or 20 times an hour, through, and they go through a HEPA filter, which screens out 99.7% of all microbes. So I think number one priority is to ensure all the health and safety measures are taken. That being said, I think we think there's an inherent demand for travel. I think at this point we're working with the government slowly to ensure that our partners in government, the various LGUs, are reassured that their own cities are ready to take on new visitors. So I think that this is an ongoing conversation and process. But I'm highly confident that once this is all sorted out, that travel demand will return. Maybe not back to previous levels. That will take a couple of years, especially on the international side. But I think there is latent demand out there, and we're seeing this actually in all our neighbors, Thailand, Vietnam, Malaysia, and Indonesia have all liberalized their own domestic travel markets, and we're seeing that in those areas we're flying about 10% of our schedules now. I think in those countries they're already up to between 50 to 90% of their previous schedules. So I think it's just a matter of assuring our partners in government and the LGUs that the country and the airlines are prepared to support safe and convenient travel.
This inherent latent demand you're seeing for travel, in terms of the changed consumer behaviors, so what are your plans in terms of flight destinations and fleet?
Well, by the end of the month, we intend to be flying to about 20 domestic cities. We are with about 21 routes, primarily out of hubs in Manila and Clark. We'll start with that first. We'll see how the demand goes. I think by the end of the month, we hope to be at about, I would say about 10 to 15% of our previous schedules. So I think, again, it's a question of really rebuilding, assuring the public and our LGU partners of that flying is something that is sustainable and is safe.
Yeah, you know, before COVID-19, JG Summit had already taken a dive into the digital space. What impact has the pandemic had on that pace at which you're getting on with the conglomerate's digital transformation? I mean, you've poured in at least $40 million into tech startups.
I think digital for us is not just a question of investing in tech startups. I think really even before the COVID crisis, we were investing heavily in digital. I think digital in not only in terms of the tools and the enablement it brings, but even the culture of being much more customer centric, much more agile, and much more fast in the way we operate. So I think the COVID crisis has just merely accelerated and reinforced what we have to do, and we just have to do we just have to move in a much more quicker manner now, and just dive, you know, head on. I think there's no other way about it.
A quicker manner. So what is this acceleration then going to mean in digital transformation for your customers? I mean, how does it change the way you'll engage your end user? Maybe cite some examples across the conglomerate of what the customer experience will be.
Okay, I think I can cite, for instance, our retail group, our drugstore, South Star Drug. We now have a website that's been operational. This was brought from us from conception to actualization in 2 months, this at southstardrug.com. We have a pilot now for Robinson Supermarket, also started within 6 weeks in certain parts of the Philippines. It's at gorobinsons.ph. So both are now e-commerce site that can deliver to your home. I think we saw this in Cebu Pacific, where in the last 3 months, we've already set up an entirely new way of looking at the customer journey, where all the check-in processes are digital, so that the handovers are require less human interaction. You're seeing this in the bank, where we've set up an app where customers can actually set up accounts without having to go to the branch, no? And at URC, for instance, we've already set up sites in Lazmart, where we are now selling directly to consumers, no? For our snack and coffee and other URC products. So in each of our businesses, we have had to demonstrate the capability to move with agility and force in order to address the changing consumer behavior and the consuming different channel behavior.
Just a final point, Lance. What shape do you think recovery of the Philippine economy, what shape will it take? Your best guess, peering through the proverbial crystal ball.
I think different businesses will recover at different rates. I'm fundamentally optimistic about the Philippine recovery, about Philippines, primarily because our balance sheet remains strong. I think Philippine workers are needed, especially in a lot of the service sectors, a lot of the health sectors, and a lot of the growing BPO sector. So I do expect that we should begin to see recovery beginning the third and fourth quarter. I don't expect, though, that we will be back to January 2020 numbers until maybe the latter part of more like 2022. I think 21 is going to be a strong recovery year, but I think we'll be back to 2020 by 2022.
You think you're going to go back flying this year, Lance?
Right.
Are you going to go back flying this year?
Oh, definitely. I'm going to hop on the first flight I can.
Okay. Yeah. All right. We'll watch for that. Thanks for your time, the opportunity as well. I appreciate it. You keep well, Lance Gokongwei of JG Summit Holdings.
Thanks, Patty.